Hi, I'm Laura Cruz Colon from Trinity Independent Assembly of God Church right here in Mamaroneck. We're located at 421 Ward Avenue, and we wish to welcome you to Hope in the Bible. We do have ministries that we would like to mention before we start our show, and they are as follows. On Sundays at 10 o'clock, we have our Sunday worship, our praise and glory worship, and then our regular worship, our regular service. And do come by. Consider coming by and visiting us. We do have a wonderful, wonderful time. We have two new pastors, Pastors John and Mary DeMarco, and they have been a blessing, a God-sent blessing to our church. Then we have Monday nights. We have our prayer meeting, and then that is at 7 o'clock. And shortly after that, we have a Bible study that for now, until after Labor Day, is suspended, but it will be resuming as soon as Labor Day is over. Then on Tuesday nights, we have another Bible study with Joe Guglielmo, who facilitates and leads the Bible study. And very interesting, it's a round table type of Bible study, and all are welcome. We also have a prayer line. There's a lot of people out there that I know that need prayer. And don't hesitate to call our prayer line. We have a wonderful man of God, Pastor Richie Smalley, and he can be reached at 914-574-5068. We also have Bible questions. It's a Bible question line. If you have any Bible questions that you may need to have answered or explained to, please feel free to call or come by our church on one of the nights that we do Bible studies. We also have a miracle line. There's so many people out there, myself included, that we've experienced miracles in our lives, and we have to really, really acknowledge them as miracles because there's nothing else that we can describe them as. Every third Wednesday of every month, we have movie night, and that is a fun time for us because we get to enjoy each other's companies, watch a good movie, and we offer free popcorn and free refreshments. So come by on the third Wednesday of every month. We also have the availability of having people that are handicapped because we are handicap accessible. So come by and see us. Today's show, the topic is, and it's a very interesting topic, it's called I wish to express to you that this is a continuation from our last program, the one that I did with Nancy Stagno, and it's based on how does God minister to us in the time of grief? Well, after we lose someone so precious as a spouse, but yet not limiting grief to just the loss of our partners, but to anyone in our lives, be it a parent, a child, a family member, and sometimes even a close and dear friend. And how is it that we can allow God to help us? Okay. He will. He definitely will. You see, the Lord, He's close to the brokenhearted, as it says in Psalms 34:18. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He rescues those who are crushed in spirit. So you see, God ministers to you through His comforting presence. You know, at first, when we lose someone so dear and so close, we can't even imagine, let alone in that precise moment, think of how are we going to deal with this? Well, for me, all I can think of was to thank the Lord. And I really did. I thank you, God, for being right here when I need you the most. And He was. Yet, as I thought about the various circumstances in my life, and I realized, wow, God has always been here when I needed Him the most. Because I've had a lot of most moments in my life. But that confirmed to me that God is always with us for he never leaves us and he never forsakes us. And I know that without question, without him, I would not have survived. That goes without saying. One of the many things that I have come to understand is that God comforts as he ministers in one's grief. And he does this through his personal attention to us, letting me know that he loves us. He really loves us. And all we have to do is go to him in prayer. We go to him in worship. We go to him in meditation. And yes, sometimes we even go to him in silence. Which brings me to a favorite saying that I have adopted as one of my models in life. And I'm going to share with you right now. Lord, keep your arms around my shoulder and your hand over my mouth. Because sometimes we have to just stop and listen to God. It's not just about asking God, you know, for anything, whether it's to help me with an illness or to help me with a situation in a relationship or to help me with my finances. No, sometimes we just have to be quiet and listen to God because he does talk to us. He does speak to us. And a lot of times, even though he speaks to us, we're not listening. We're not acknowledging him because we're too busy and we're too much in a hurry and we have too much to ask him for and we have too much to you know, just demand from him. We don't have to demand anything from God. He gives it all to us. All we have to do is seek his kingdom first and everything else will fall in its place according to his will in our life. Because that's what I've come to understand, that everything is according to God's will in my life. Paul, in Romans 8:26-27, Paul tells us that the Holy Spirit helps us in our distress. And it's true, I've experienced that in my life. For we don't even know what we should pray for, nor how should we pray. But the Holy Spirit prays for us with groaning that cannot be expressed in words. And the Father, who knows all hearts and knows what the Spirit is saying, for the Spirit pleads for us, believers, in harmony with God's will. It's all about God's will. I suppose that someone will ask, why does God do this for us? Well, as stated in Romans 8:28, and we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. Yes, he has a purpose for all of us. And sometimes when we are so wrapped up in our grief, we seem to forget that no matter what, hey, God is in control. He's got this and he will take care of it and he will help us through this. So we must concentrate on that purpose that God has in our lives instead of focusing on the lost, the grief, and the pain. Not that one shouldn't grieve. King Solomon said it very, very clearly in Ecclesiastes 3:1. To everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. And Ecclesiastes 3:4, he tells us, there's a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. Now, in relation to grief, there's pain. So along with grief, there is pain. And in that moment, we all want to know, what will heal my pain? The psalmist says in Psalms 25:17-18, my problems go from bad to worse. First, my husband was sick, and then he died. And then other things happened that didn't help the situation. But in that moment, when we were asking, how is this pain going to heal? Okay, when my problems have gone from bad to worse, the psalmist says, oh, save me from them all. Feel my pain and see my trouble. Forgive my sins. Wow, this gave me such a rude awakening. Forgive my sins. Okay, so when I go to God for help, when I go to God for anything, I should first be thankful. I should first acknowledge the fact that, hey, I need your forgiveness because I too am a sinner, okay, just like everybody else. And there's things that I need to be forgiven for because I am human and there are things that I just do as a human does. But I have to acknowledge that and I have to ask God to forgive me, accept His forgiveness, and forgive anyone that I feel has hurt me or has caused me pain. In other words, acknowledge your pain to God in prayer and start by calling to Him for help with forgiveness in your heart, asking Him to forgive you of whatever, and only you and Him know the whatever. This is where one needs to begin the process of healing. Now, although pain does not originate for everyone from the same source, it's still pain. Someone could lose a child, but that child is not just the child of that parent. That child could be a nephew of an uncle, a nephew of an aunt, a grandchild of a grandparent, or even a child of a great-grandparent. They too are feeling pain. So, you know, pain is pain, regardless of its origin. However, regardless of the pain or its origin, God can and will help us through it if we allow Him to. Now, without question, we should consider to seek help from godly counselors. Sometimes it's just not enough to seek the advice of trusted friends or family members. At other times, it is necessary to talk with a trained counselor who can help you pinpoint your pain and provide effective ways that you can consider to adhere to in accordance with God's word to deal. But pain is something that we all can count on one thing about, and that we can learn. We can learn from this pain that we're going through. So in the future, okay, we can always remember that, yes, it's painful, it hurts, but God is bigger than this. God is bigger than everything. And, you know, you can do that by strength. Where does one find strength in God? Well, God can give us the strength that we need. Philippians 4:13 says that, for I can do everything with the help of Christ who gives me the strength I need. There are no limits to what God can do in and through us. All we need to do is to trust Him and trust Him with all our heart and all our faith and all our strength. It's easier said than done, but it's so, so doable. Psalms 18:1-2 says that, the psalmist says, I love you, Lord. You are my strength. Here he is clearly proclaiming the Lord is his rock. He is his fortress and he is his savior. He is the shield, the strength, and the salvation. And he is our stronghold. No question about it. In your strength, I can crush an army. With God, I can scale any wall. And as for God, His way is perfect. All the Lord's promises prove that to be very true. And believe this, God's word does not come back void. So when God promises us that He's going to help us, when God promises us that He's going to help us heal, when He promises that He's never going to leave us, that He's never going to forsake us, believe it because his word does not come back void. Now, in Ephesians 3:20, it says that glory be to God, but because by his mighty work within us, he is able to accomplish infinitely more than what we would ever dare ask or hope. Know this, that God's strength is in you, or God's strength in you is a result of his love for you. Because in his strength, you have the power to do things that you could never do on your own. I know I'm a product of that. Every time that I've tried to do things on my own without consulting God, never worked out until the day that I got it. Now, I consult him for everything, okay? And I remember hearing one time about Toti Osteen, who, when she, you know, she was going through a horrific phase in her life, and she was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. Pancreatic cancer is like, forget about it. Just say goodbye, wrap up your affairs, because it's a done deal. But this woman, she looked at the doctor and she said, okay. She picked herself up, she went home, and she locked herself up in a room and refused to accept that diagnosis. And she started worshiping the Lord, she started praising the Lord, and she started thanking the Lord for her healing. And today, many, many years later, that woman is still alive. And this is a woman that not only has this amazing testimony, but this is a woman that prayed about everything, asked God and counseled God for everything, okay? Even when a toaster broke, she would pray about it, and that toaster would work. And that was called faith. That is what we call faith. To have that faith, to have gotten this point in my life where I have so much faith in everything that God does, because I see his work every single day in my life, every single day that I wake up, every single day that I go to bed. I have to be thankful, because if not for him, that day would have been a disaster. And I just can't put it any other way. I love the Lord. I know that there's a lot of people out there that are hurting, and a lot of people out there that may not understand. Okay, so I can only say to you that if you're curious just a little bit about what God has done for me and what this hope in the Bible, okay, does for me and can do for you, give yourself the opportunity to get to know the Word of God. Knowing the Word of God is knowing God. And if you don't know where to start, you can start by visiting our church or visiting any church of your choosing, okay? God will lead you. Ask him to lead you where he wants you. That's the best way to find a good-based, godly church, by asking him to lead you. That's how I got to the church that I am today, and I've been in this church for over 30 years, and I'm proud to say it, that I have never looked back once I started my walk with the Lord. And it's been an amazing ride for me, and you know, he has given me so much strength that I can't even begin to describe it in words. I don't think there's enough words for me to describe it. But know this, that God's strength is in you, is a result of his love for you. And in his strength, you have the power to do things that you could never do on your own. I have come to the understanding that grief can help one have the compassion and the capability to comfort others. So even though, you know, in the moment that you're going through your grief, you just don't want to hear anything. You just want to savor your pain, or you maybe you're not able to just understand that, listen, this hurts, this is horrible. To lose someone that you love is just painful. But God, trust him, he will He will help you through it. And one of the things that has helped me is that I have learned that, hey, for whatever reason I'm going through this, God has the answer. And when I'm ready to be receptive to His answer, He will show it to me. He will reveal it to me. You know, sometimes I wonder, I don't know about anybody else, but I think about how did Jesus grieve, okay? Because He grieved Himself. He not only grieved, He didn't grieve about what was going to happen to Him. He didn't grieve about what He was ordained, the purpose in His life for coming to this world was. He grieved for us. And when in Luke 19:41-42, it says that, but as they came closer to Jerusalem, and Jesus saw ahead, and He saw the city ahead, He began to cry. And you know, He began to cry. But He wasn't crying for Himself. He knew what was ahead. He knew what was going to happen to Him. But He wasn't crying for Himself. He was crying for us. And all He could think of and say to us was that I wish that even today you would find a way of peace, the peace that passes all understanding, the peace that He left with us. That's how we handle grief and pain with the strength that God provides, by allowing His peace to be the driving force in our lives. Amazing to me that in my grief, I found comfort in Jesus. And going through my grief, that I can now, okay, share my grief experience with someone else who may not understand, okay, and hopefully help them in their process of making peace with their grief and allowing Jesus to help them with this process. You know, I can't speak enough about the loss of my husband, which July 29th was 3 years. I miss him terribly, and I know that he's in a better place. But I also rejoice because, you know, I understand so much from reading God's word. You know, to be present, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And that is the hope that I have for everyone that I love, as well as for myself. And I wish that for every one of you. Allow God's peace to come into your heart. Allow it to be the driving force that you need to have so you can deal with every single day. Before I go, I would like to do a little something different. We have daily devotionals that I know that I love to read my daily devotional every single day, and this is part of what I use to study with the Bible. So today, I would like to share what the message was. It's called Reproof and Chasten, Submit to God's Correction. And this is just a little something that I want to share with you all. God's correction humbles us in ways we need to be humbled. And when He does it, we have the options. We have three options. We have the option to rebel against Him, and we have the option to rationalize and make excuses. And thirdly, we have the option to receive His correction and get back on track. But lasting change can't even begin until you accept that God loves you unconditionally and just as you are. Without that, you'll keep trying to change yourself in vain, attempt to earn His love and acceptance. The truth is, you already have it. You just don't know it. Many of us think that by accepting ourselves, we are excusing all things that are wrong with us. Not. You can't properly receive God's correction until you cleared an understanding of how much he loves you. Without that, you'll interpret his correction as rejection and see his disapproval of your behavior as disapproval of you. To grow spiritually, you must believe that God is committed to you, especially when he deals with you correctively and leads you in ways you don't understand. During such times, you must have an unshakable trust in his love for you. The Apostle Paul was convinced that nothing could separate him from God's love. And you can, and as we're told in Romans 8:39. In Revelation chapter 3, God is speaking to each of us when he says, "Those whom I dearly and tenderly love, I tell their faults. Convict and convince, reprove and chasten." One of the strongest evidence of God's love and acceptance is his correction. Make no mistake about that. Indeed, you should be concerned about the absence of it. So if God's correcting you right now, take heart and rejoice. It means he has good things in store for you. I want to take this opportunity to just thank my viewers, our viewers, for once again allowing us to come into your home and to share the hope that sustains us, which is the hope in the Bible. Thank you and good night, and God bless you all.